You know that moment when you, like, aim at a button and press C, it activates something, right? Or even better, when you walk into a trigger brush and that activates something. How is any of that possible? Well, it's not hard. Let's start with using first. So first of all, let's roughly define what it actually is in Half-Life. Using is an event where an entity triggers another. This has many cool implications and uses. A special variant of using is player use. And that happens when the player presses E or whatever button is assigned as the use button, aiming at an entity that supports it. In fact, we've already done using in the previous video with trigger print. You are already aware that the use method is called whenever an entity is triggered by another. And when that does happen, we have information on who directly triggered the entity and who's responsible for it being triggered in the first place. So let's actually use that information to do something really cool. So I wrote a new entity called TriggerSetHealth. I imagined it as an entity that sets the player's health. All the player has to do is to trigger this entity somehow. Start by writing this in the use method. Here, we're basically checking if the activator is in fact the player. Earlier, I explained that PEV contains a bunch of common variables and one of them is health. So yeah, you can just do it that way, set the health variable to 100. This means whenever the entity is triggered by a player, it'll set their health to 100. Now, we might want to let the mapper specify the amount of health as well, so let's replace this 100 with PEV health. This will be initialized from the health key value, so update your FGD accordingly. Well, that was simple. Now, you might also want to clamp this value between 1 and 100, unless you really want to set the player's health to 200 or something. It'd be really cool if you want to do that for your mod, though. Thinking is basically periodic updating of entities. In other words, an entity can update itself every couple of seconds, minutes, or milliseconds, whatever you want. If you worked with a modern game engine, this is kind of similar to processing Godot update in Unity and CryEngine or Tick in Unreal Engine. Entities have a PEVNext think, which is basically the time point when think can be called again. NPCs use thinking to analyze their situation, whether they'll attack or not, every fraction of a second, for example, but not every frame. That would be too expensive. So let's do something interesting with the think method. Let's make an entity that produces sparks at a custom defined speed, like every 0.2 seconds or 4, but it can be triggered as well. So it's gonna have a use method and a think method. First, obviously, you gotta override the think and use methods in the class. We'll need to store our on and off state somewhere. We can abuse PEV variables like PEV health, or we can add a Boolean variable to the class itself. Now we can work. In the use method, we'll simply be flipping this variable. In the think method, we gotta check if the entity can spark, and if it can, then we're gonna emit sparks with a special utility function. You've noticed so far that think doesn't have any parameters unlike use, touch, and others. So let's compile this thing and... It works. But why does it work? Well, first we gotta understand how the engine actually calls the think method. There's this part of the code called a game loop, and if we take a look at the Quake source code, because Gold Source is based on Quake, we'll see it looks something like this for Windows. This is part of the winMain function in syswin.c. And as you can see, it's all one big while loop. Down the road, HostFrame calls a bunch of stuff. But most importantly though, it calls HostServerFrame. ServerFrame, apart from managing the clients and other stuff, calls the physics code. SVPhysics is called every server tick. And it basically does a for loop going through each entity in the map and running physics for it. And finally, each of these functions call the think function of the current entity, if that can be done. What a revelation, isn't it? So here you can see the logic which executes think functions. It depends on the think time, which is in fact next think. Ultimately, we can form some sort of pseudocode. So what that means is, it goes through every entity and calls its think function. In the Half-Life SDK, there are several dispatcher functions which are exported to the engine. One of them is dispatch think. Now, this is where Gold Source gets a little different from Quake. And obviously, what dispatch think does is call the entity's think function. Now, I hope you understand at least a little bit better why our entity worked as intended. There's a huge while loop in the background and it calls think only if next think is smaller than the current server time. Now that your brain has expanded 20 times, let's make a brush entity and let's overwrite touch. Touch only has one parameter, that is pother. Obviously, it is the entity that touched our entity. So let's make another new entity, this time, func trampoline. You heard me right, we're gonna make a trampoline. When the player touches it, the player gets pushed up. It's really simple. Now, if you really wanted to get physical, you could like take into account the player's velocity and stuff like that, but for the sake of simplicity, we're just gonna keep it this way. Brush entities require a bit more setup than point entities, because you gotta set up three things, a brush model, a solidity type, and a movement type, all in the spawn function, but it's pretty simple. Move type controls in what way the entity is gonna move, solid controls whether it's solid or passable or otherwise, and so on. It's kinda obvious. Let's override touch as well, and write the following code. This is gonna push the player upwards by about 1300 units per second. In other words, the player is gonna forcibly jump. Isn't this kinda cool? Touch is kinda similar to think, because it is checked for every frame and called only when entities touch each other. You can use it for various things, like healing the player on touch, or hurting the player, or hey, blowing up literally anything that touches it. Let's actually do that for a second. So first of all, you're gonna include the explode header. It has this explosion create function in it. And then in the touch code, write explosion create with these parameters here. Now our trampoline is a deadly explosive. You can do anything you want, basically. I suggest you experiment with this on your own, so you can do some really cool stuff by yourself. I don't have to show you everything you can do with this, right? Now, this video had a lot of stuff, and we've made like three different entities to demonstrate what each thing does. If we take a look at C-base entity again, we can see that there are many other methods that we can override, like take damage, pre-cache, object caps, and many, many more. Those are all coming soon eventually, just don't worry about that. You can notice that some of these call function pointers, in other words, methods like think, touch, and use can be quite modular. For example, buttons can disable their use methods when they're pressed, then they think for a number of seconds before they can be used again. You can imagine that as some kind of mode of operation. For example, the helicopter has a hunting mode and a dying mode, which are really just a bunch of different think methods. We'll take a look at them all in upcoming videos. And until then, happy programming!